Good evening and welcome to today's webinar. We will be discussing about time series analysis, and as part of this time series analysis we will be learning on how to predict a binary event on time series data. So most of you guys have undergone the logistic regression training, right? So when we talk about logistic regression, we will be trying to predict a binary output, right? So y is equals to f of x, this is the equation, and if the y is binary data, then as part of this regression techniques we will be applying logistic regression for predicting this binary output. This is something that you all of you guys know. Now, before we actually dive into this time series, we have to first understand what exactly is a time series. So all this while, we were talking about cross-sectional data. When a historical data is given, right, that data can be classified into two types: cross-sectional data and time series data. So cross-sectional data is what we were looking into all this while. For example, adipose tissue waist circumference, miles per gallon, if I have to predict that using some input variables like volume, horsepower, top speed, yeah, maybe a few other characteristics of the vehicles. Using this, I will have to predict the miles per gallon. These are as part of your linear regression examples. In logistic regression, we discussed about a tourney being hired or not hired. You can also extend these in various examples like the customer defaulting or not defaulting. Yep. Cancer, no cancer. Student pass or fail. So like this, you can talk about a lot of examples in binary form. And in all these examples, there was no reference to time. When was the first patient, say let's talk about cancer. A number of patients are there for a hospital, and there are cancer patients and non-cancer patients, and using that historical data we have to predict whether a new patient who is getting admitted is having cancer or not. So in such cases, if you look at the data, there was no reference to time here. That means, when was the first patient, your first record, that means, when was this first patient admitted in the hospital? When was the second patient admitted in the hospital? All this information was not disclosed or was not considered at all, right? So this data is absolutely recorded at random times. Or in other terms, we can say that the data was collected irrespective of time, or all the data was recorded at a single point of time. This is called as cross-sectional data. Now the other type of data that we have is called as time series data. That means the data that we are collecting will be in series form, and that would be with reference to time. That means, let's say January, a patient is walking in and we are recording his details, let's say some tumor. The same patient comes in February month and we are again measuring the tumor. Then March, same calculation. So like this, over a period of time, what is the effect of that tumor? Is it converting into a cancer tumor or not? So here if you see, this data that we are gathering for this prospective customer is in series. in series form. And with respect to time, first month, second month, third month, right, in sequence. This kind of data is called as time series data. And of course, we'll have to, a lot of new joinees here, you might not have looked into the forecasting topic. A lot of students might not have undergone this. So when we talk about forecasting, we will be covering about time series data. Now, whenever we have this time series data, we have to deal with this data in a different way. You cannot apply the same techniques that we have discussed as part of cross-sectional data to this time series data. Okay, so the analysis changes. Now, this is how your typical time series data looks like. So here, over time, let's say month on month, we are collecting on how many people were using this railway service. There is a railway service called Amtrak, right, which is run in US. Over month on month, how many people used this railway service? January month, 1709,000. February, 1621,000. So on and so forth, we are collecting in sequence of time. And this data is assumed that we have data from 91 till 2004. So the time series here, if you observe, we are talking about the same railway service. And over a period of time, once we have the sizable data, using this historical data, we should be able to predict or forecast what could be the ridership, let's say in July 92. Assume you are still in June 92. Assume this is 92 year, we are in June. So I want to predict what will be the ridership value in July. So July 92 will have some forecasted value. Using techniques, we will have two forecasting techniques. We have to do that. We'll be discussing about one such technique when you have binary data. And before you go ahead, you need to understand the jargons of this time series data. Now, remember I said that this data is collected in sequence, right? So here we give sequence number to this data, and that sequence number is called as time period index. Index, serial number. 1, 2, 3, 4, so on and so forth. You have till 18 here. Time period index, which is represented using T. Next, the value that we are collecting is called as response value, and here it is ridership, which is represented using Y of T, where T takes values from 1 to 18 here. So this is Y of 1, Y of 2, Y of 3, so on and so forth. We have Y of 18. Then when you are talking about future values, it is represented using Y of T plus K, where K represents the future value. T is this maximum time period that we have. And if you add plus 1, if K is equals to 1 here, then this becomes Y of 18 plus 1, which is equals to Y of 19. And that would be July 92. This is how we represent. If I say K is equals to 6, then I have to say Y of 18 plus 6, which is equals to Y of 24, and that would be December 92 time period. And using this historical data, we should be able to forecast this Y of 24 value. And just like your regression analysis and the prediction methods, we'll also have error term here, which is basically saying how wrong you're predicting from your actual value. We have predicted something, right? Y of hat t. But when you are predicting this, how long you are going? That is E of t. Actual value minus forecasted value. Same Jordan, same understanding that of your cross-sectional data. I'm not going into details of this. Then we will have to understand the various components that you'll have in time series data. The time series data, right, is basically split into two parts. First part is called as systematic part. The second part is called as non-systematic part. Systematic means it has certain patterns, right? Some structure to it. And as part of the systematic part, we have three different components that we need to understand. First one is level, which is nothing but simple average. You take any time series data, we'll have average associated to it. Any data, right? We can calculate average. Then next we have trend. Trend is nothing but the overall increase or decrease in your response variable with respect to time. So on x-axis you will have time, and here on y-axis you will be plotting the response variable y of t. And what is happening to it? When it started here, but when it ended over this period, it ended here. So if you look at this, there is an upward trend here. It is increasing, right? So this is upward trend. You might also see a trend like this going downwards. The y of t started here when the time period started, t is equals to 1, and over period of time, the response has fallen down. So net difference is what we try to look at. So this is downward trend. So trend is nothing but overall increase or decrease in the response variable over the time period t. Then we have seasonal component, seasonality, okay? So every season we talk about seasons, and if I have 1 year time, generally this is the time frame that we take if I have to talk about seasonality. If I talk about 1 year, then in 1 year I'll have 12 different months, right? Each month is a season here. And every year, these 12 months or 12 seasons repeat. One complete cycle. So January, it started at January. And if you look at this circle, it will again start at January the next year. So 12 months make one cycle. Now we are looking into this data, one complete cycle, and we are trying to find out whether the pattern repeats with itself for this period of time, one complete cycle time. And if you see, this is, let's say, 1, this is 12, December. Again, the next year, you see, observe, the same pattern is repeated here. Here also the same pattern is repeated. So this repetition for a specific interval of time, that is called as seasonality. So to explain it in a very simple terms, if you look into, let's say, sales of cakes, I always use this example. Month on month, if I want to look at the sales of cakes, when do you think the sales would be maximum? Yeah, Alex. When do you think the sales would be maximum?
In December.
Right, December.
Right, because you December. Because you have
Christmas, you have Christmas, New Year.
New Year, yeah.
So the maximum number of sales would be there in December. Now, do you think let's say I want to predict, this is some data set that I have, let's say from 2010 to 2017. Okay, now we are in 2018, I want to predict the sales for December 2018. We are currently in June 2018. Now if I have to forecast for December 2018, do you think the sales would be similar to June 2018? The case sale? Or is it in May? Or is it February? Or is it January? Or this sales would be similar to December 2017? When do you think the sales would be similar to this December 2018? Yeah, you have to go back exactly 12 months back in time, and we see that every December the sales would repeat itself. Right? So this is called as seasonality, and it is represented using capital M. Typical size of seasonality is measured for 1 year, which is nothing but 12. This 12 months make 1 year. So this seasonality is regular up and down fluctuations. Occurs generally in 1 year, but it depends on what kind of data we are collecting. Say for example, you are collecting data of a traffic movement, let's say from a signal, traffic signal. 24/7 you are collecting the data from a traffic signal. Then what do you think would be the seasonality? Exactly. Here we are collecting the data on hourly basis, right? So how many hours make one day? 24 hours, right? You just have to imagine that you want to predict a value of traffic flow, let's say at 9 a.m. at this particular signal, let's say some signal is there. This 9 a.m. traffic would be similar to the next day 9 a.m. signal, right? 9 a.m. time. It would not be similar to 10 a.m. of the same day. It would not be similar to 9 p.m. same day. After 24 hours, if I see, there is next day 9 a.m. and exactly on that time, you'll have the same traffic. Right? So based on what granularity and what kind of data we are collecting in, the seasonality changes. And in simple terms, seasonality means one complete cycle. That's what we have to remember. If I'm collecting daily sales, for example, of let's say some movie tickets, or you can talk about the same Amtrak data that I'm collecting on. Let's say I'm collecting the data on daily basis. Then what would be the seasonality?
Every day.
So seasonality.
One day.
Seven would be
seasonality.
Okay.
Alright. So this is about, I request everyone to be on mute. There is an echo coming up. Yeah, thank you. All right. So this is about the systematic part, in which we discussed about level, trend, seasonality. And now we'll have non-systematic part, which is also called as irregular, random. This data will not have any kind of pattern to it. That means it does not follow any structure. It is unsystematic, it is noise component, right? So it would be random. It was also called as erratic. It was also called as residual. You will not be able to predict anything for these kind of noise components. These are absolutely going to occur on random basis. Example, you have union strike, wars, right? These events would generally be for short duration. We're talking about time series data, right? So short duration would be the time frame for these kind of noise components. And they generally don't repeat. They're random, right? You'll not be able to predict also. Okay, now let us talk about predicting stuff for these kind of models. In forecasting or in time series analysis, the models can be classified broadly into model-based and data-driven techniques. When I say model-based, the logic here is past will be equal to future. We are assuming that. And what we're trying to do is we have a model, okay? We have a framework or we have a structure. Like linear regression, which says it's a straight line, right? And there would be a time series data. Now, when I say model based, we take this model and try to fit this model to the given data and check whether these are fitting properly or not. Of course, we try to tweak the model a little bit and make sure it fits the better, it fits the data better. We will be able to do this because of this assumption, past is equal to future. That means data has a certain flow to it. The data is not having any volatility, it is not changing too much. And as part of this, we have linear regression, all regression techniques, autoregressive, this is also part of regression, logistic regression, which is there. ARIMA is an ensemble model, of course. Then we have econometric models. This is also similar to regression analysis. Okay. Past equals to future is the assumption for model based. We will be discussing about logistic regression now, where we have binary data. Right? So over a period of time, given the data for a patient, whether the patient is going to develop a cancer or not. Right? Now, when Google has come up with a prediction model, which is going to predict the death date of patients at 95% accuracy. Recently, this has come up. Right? So, Google is now also telling us whether you're going to die soon or you're going to live for a long time. Okay, anyways, that's something that we're out of this scope. So we'll be looking into this logistic regression now, but let me first explain about data-driven before going into logistic regression. So model-based is clear, right? We have a model, we have a frame or a structure to the model, and we are trying to see whether these models fit the data better or not, or which model is fitting the data better. Then we have data-driven techniques, and here we'll not take any fixed models. As per the data, we try to fit a model. Okay, it's not the other way around. And here the assumption is past is not equal to future. That means there is too much of volatility. Data is changing too frequently. In such cases, we go by naive forecast methods, smoothing techniques, neural networks, etc., etc., etc. There are a few techniques that you might want to look into. Anyways, now let us try and understand how logistic regression fits in here in time series data. Now, when do we go with logistic regression, guys? when we have binary output. Exactly. Y is binary. So forecast the direction of numerical series. We are not forecasting for a particular value y. Right? We are basically checking whether the value is going upwards or downwards. Yep. Recession, will an event occur or not? We are talking about future here, T plus K. It could be any, whether an employee is going to resign or not. That's one example. Whether a person is going to get a job or not. You're trying to forecast or the unemployment scenario here, right? And will a value cross a threshold of interest at a particular time or not? Again, this is also binary, whether it is crossing the value or not. Now, we are going to talk about a time series data which is given for Melbourne. This is the data set. You can extract the data from this open website. And here we have data from 2000 till October 2011. These are all univariate time series models. Sure, I'll try. All right. So here we have daily data. Okay. From January 1st, 2000, we are collecting data on a daily basis. And this is the rainfall amount, which is given in millimeters. And yeah, this is a continuous value that we have, right? But here we are going to forecast whether there is going to be a rain or not using this historical data. So we have to predict binary result, and hence we are converting this rainfall amount into rain, whether falling or not. So if there is some reading, then we say it rained. If it is zero, then we say it did not rain. Like this. Okay. Now, so this is what we have to forecast for November 1st, assume rainfall or no rainfall. And this is the typical data set that we have. So the first thing we have to do is whenever a data is given to us, we have to partition it. For prediction, we have to do the partitioning. One partition is called as training data. The other partition is called as validation or test data. And this is a very, very long time series data. And we have partitioned it like this. 3653 days into training data, that is till December 2009. And from 2010, we have taken 668 days into validation data. And when we are talking about time series data, we always have to take the most recent data into validation period. Right? So because let's say if you have to forecast for November 2011, it makes more sense for us to test the model on October 2011. Because over time, if you see, October is very close to November. Rather than testing it on, let's say, January 2011 or maybe some January 2009. Right? Hence, we have to take the most recent data into validation data so that when I build this model and when I verify it on this validation data, we can assume that it is going to work on similar lines for your future data as well. That's the idea. Now, if I talk about No, it is time series data, Shalini. You cannot take randomly. It has to be in sequence. Whenever you're dealing with time series, it has to be in order or in sequence. For cross-sectional data, it can be random because there is no reference to time there, right? The data is in fact collected randomly. So you can partition the data also randomly, but here it has to be in sequence. And most recent data should be your validation data. Okay, now let us understand the logistic regression. Whenever we talk about logistic regression, what does it do here basically in logistic regression? What is that we are predicting? Yeah guys, what is that we are predicting in logistic regression? That's right. We are trying to predict the probability of an event. This logistic regression does not give the output as Y. Rather, it talks about the probability of event Y. So first we take the linear relationship between the variables, right? And then we have probability function which calculates e power 1 by e power, right? This is the probability function that we have. Sorry? Okay. Now when we look into this time series data, the output is binary, which is whether rain is falling or not falling. We have to predict this output. And the data is given on daily basis. So we have very lengthy data, one, yeah, from 2000 till 2011. And we are collecting the data daily. So what would be the seasonality, guys, here? We are talking about 1 year.
Yeah.
It will be 365 days. We have one complete year, so it has to be 365 days. So we will be using this equation to capture the seasonality. There is a lengthy article which talks about using sine and cos values to capture the seasonality, annual seasonality. You can try and look into this articles, which are readily available. You can just do an exploration of that. And because we also have leap years, we have leap years, right? Which basically says 366 days, which actually is split into 4 partitions, 0.25, 0.25, 0.25. Hence, we take this value 365.25 to make sure we are capturing that leap year's data as well. And to predict the rainfall, we have to take one lagged value. Last sample technique. So did it rain yesterday or not? Because here we are capturing daily data, right? So we are looking into the one-stepped lag data, which is nothing but yesterday's data, if I have to predict for today. So this equation is rain at time period t is equals to beta naught plus beta 1 rain at yesterday t minus 1 plus beta 2 sine into 2 pi t by 365.25 plus beta 3 cosine of 2 pi t by 365.25. And of course, you have error term as well. So this is basically capturing the seasonality, annual seasonality. Yeah, yeah, that's right. See, when I talk about leap year comes every 4 years, right? Which actually basically, which actually talks about the year size is 365.25. This is 1 year size, but we generally don't consider that. We add all this and we consider as 366 after 4 years. So that is considered here actually when you do the calculations. Now, when we talk about logistic regression, it is applied for cross-sectional data. It is also applied for time series data, as we have seen now. We have to predict the binary outcome. And when we do the prediction, we have to calculate the probability of the outcome. But we are using linear regression first. Okay, it gives us an output which is similar to linear regression. The equation that we have seen, y is equals to beta naught plus beta 1 y of t minus 1 plus beta 2 into sine 2 pi t by 365.25 plus beta 3 cos of 2 pi t by 365.25, right? So this is the equation. And it is very similar to your linear regression, right? You have coefficients and all that. But the actual equation that we have to see here is, we don't want this rain, right? We are not looking into the rain value. But when we capture, or in the logistic regression, if we have to predict, we have to use a function of rain, which is nothing but probability function here, that's what we call it, which predicts or forecasts the range of values as either 0 or 1. That is based on the probability. Now let us look into this equation. To begin with, your output variable is binary. Yes, this is what we have to predict. If I take rain occurring as 1, and if I say probability of the rain occurring is p, then we have odds of rain occurring in this equation, where 1 minus p says rain of t is equals to 0. That means rain does not occur. Remember, it is binary value. So if I have probability p for this, then 1 minus p would be for this. Now odds basically says what is the ratio, or what is the chance of rain occurring by not occurring, event occurring by not occurring. This is your odds. And if I take log on both sides, then I'll get this equation, which is called as logit, which is nothing but log of odds. And this is how it looks like, odds and log of odds, which is nothing but logit function, that sigmoid curve. So basically, this is nothing but your y. See, odds is equals to p by 1 minus p, right? But this p is equal to e power y by 1 plus e power y, right? So if I substitute these values, the scribbling pad is having some issues, I'm not sure. So p by 1 minus p is odds, and this is nothing but e power y by 1 plus e power y by 1 minus e power y by 1 plus e power y. If I expand this, e power y by 1 plus e power y whole divided by 1 plus e power y minus e power y 1 plus e power y. So this gets cancelled, this gets cancelled, and you're left out with e power y. this is equal to odds, right? Odds, which is basically saying chance of odds of rain occurring by not occurring. If I take log on both sides, what will happen? Log of odds is equals to log of, this is natural logarithm. So this and this gets cancelled, you're left out with y. Now y is your equation. So that's what we are saying here. Log of odds is nothing but logit, which is equal to this equation. Right? So this is how we have to predict. Log of odds is equals to y. And if I take probability of this equation, then I'll end up getting this equation 1 by 1 plus e power minus y. This is, of course, is written as e power y by 1 plus e power y. So this is the actual equation. This can be written as 1 by 1 plus e power minus y. This means 1 by 1 plus 1 by e power y, which is nothing but e power y by 1 plus e power y. So this is how your equation looks like. So we first calculate logit value using this equation, linear equation, equation kind of a thing. Then once you have logit, we'll substitute that in the equation and we'll get probability of the event occurring. Right? And we will be looking into now Excel Miner software to handle this data. So hands on, guys. So let us go to Excel Miner. Now, a lot of people might have Excel Miner. A lot of people might have expired their Excel Miner license. So this is a cloud-based Excel Miner where you can just say excelminer.com and login, and then you'll have this Excel Miner link or tab. Click on that. It will give you this page. And here, let me first load the data. This is the data set that I have. So initially I have day and rainfall. So we are calculating rainfall lag one. That means what happened yesterday. One step lag. So you just copy all these values, ignore this value and mark zero here. Right? And here you say whether the rain fall or not. So if I hide this, I'm saying if there is a value, then I'll mark it as 1. So I'm converting it to a binary form. If there is a 0 value here, that means there is no rainfall, I'll mark it as 0. 1 means rain occurred, 0 means rain did not occur. And using this, we'll come up with lag value, rain at lag 1. When it is not there, we'll just mark it as 0. And then this is the time period index. You have to come up with this time period index. And we are calculating this sin t value, which is nothing but let me just mark this value. Seasonal sine is sine into 2 pi t by 365.25. So based on the t values, these values get affected. These two values. This is cos value, cos of 2 pi t by 365.25. And so we come up with these calculations. Lag one means what happened one step ahead, I mean one step back. So if I want to forecast for today, then the best value or the default value that we are going to check is what happened yesterday. One lag means we are going one step back in time series. That's one step lag. We can also talk about two-step lags. That means we are taking two steps back in time. So if I have to forecast for today, I'm going to look into yesterday and day before yesterday. So what event has occurred on day before yesterday? That would be the lag to value. So here if you observe on 2nd January, we are assuming that the rain was at 0.4 millimeters. So you are taking one day back and recording that value for 2nd January. So this way if I come up with prediction, right? If I go to the last value, if I have to predict on what happened on October 31st, then I'll say it would be, it rained at 3 millimeters. And if I have to talk about November 1st, 2011, then I'll say it rained, and it rained for 1.8 millimeters. That's the rainfall. If I go two steps lag, then it would be 3 years. Right, for November 1st, I have to go to two steps back, that is 31st October and 30th October. Clear? Approved? Lag one means we are going one step back. Simple. So if I want to forecast for future, right, in this logistic regression, we have to use this equation where we are taking lag one value, not season, just one step lag. When I say one seasonality back, then it would be m values backwards. So January or October 2030, or if I have to forecast for November 2011, 1st November, if I include seasonality, then this value will be predicted as the value which occurred on 2010. We are not doing this. We are not taking seasonality. We are taking lag 1 value, not lag 12 or log m value. So one step only. One day. This data is daily basis, not monthly basis. All right. So let me load the data set. We have seen this data set. Let me load this. So to load the data set in online, this Excel Miner cloud based, you click on get data and click on upload. Navigate to the data, Melbourne data, and click upload. You tell me, Shamim, it is a daily based, right? We are collecting the data on daily basis. So what would be the seasonality? We discussed this already. Yeah, Shamim, what would be the seasonality here if I'm collecting data on daily basis? No. Yeah, 365. 1 year, right? The data we are collecting is for almost 11 years. The data is on daily basis, but we are collecting it for 11 years. So the seasonality would be 365. Yes, exactly. November 1st would be equal to November 1st only in different year. That's 1 year, that is 365. To be exact, it is 365.25 if I can consider leap year also. All right, so I've loaded the data here. Now, before we build logistic regression, we build a model, we have to first partition this data. And because this is time series, we have to go for this time series partition. Click on this. It's cloud based and the data set is very large, so it is going to take a little while. It's taking a little while to load the data. Almost there. Yeah, got it. So what is the time variable here? Date, right? Just click on that date here. That's your time variable. And here we want to predict rainfall, right? Using this lag one, you have time period index, sign and cost values. Again, Tejaswini, the formula for calculating these sine values is sine of 2 pi t by 365.25 cos of 2 pi t by 365.25, and this t is time period index, which takes values from 1 till the respective time series, length of the time series that we have, which is 4322. So we have taken the inputs. I don't need these values because these are continuous values. And anyways, we are not looking into continuous values. We want to predict the binary output. So we are taking only these values. And here, let us change this to 80% and 20%. That's a long, very big data set. So I'm taking the partitions in percentage terms. 80-20, just a random number, you can select any partition. So I've clicked on partition and yeah, it's still complete, it's coming up. Yeah, done. So this is my time series. I've clicked view. Again, it is taking some time to load the data. Got it. So this is my time series, which has partition here. So training rows, I have 3, 4, 5, 8, and validation rows, I have 3, 8, 64 rows. And these are the selected variables that I've used for partitioning. So we have successfully partitioned the data. Let us come up with logistic regression for predicting the output. So here under classify, you click on that, you have logistic regression. Click on that. Again, it's taking a little while to come up with this result. Yeah, got it. So we have to make sure we are selecting the partitioned time series. So under data set, click on the drop down and select data underscore partition time series, because Excel miner will understand the training set and validation data set if I select this partition time series. Otherwise, it does not understand. If you see this data, which is your original data, it has taken everything as training data only. Right, so you have to always choose this partition time series. Now here, the output that I want to predict is rainfall. So click on this rain and click output here. You have selected this. And if you look at this equation, This is the equation. And if you see, I have rain at lagged value, use sine t value and cos t value, right? So we will be using only those values here. I'll be taking only those values. So lag value, sine t and cos t values, and selecting them, right? And then come down here. You can change the cutoff probability for your logistic regression for interpreting whether the event is going to be a true event or a false event. Classes, I have only two classes, right? Whether it is going to rain or not, binary class. So you're going to choose two here. And yeah, you can just click next and again click next. And you can choose detailed reports for scoring data and validation data if you require, if you wish to. And click finish. So your logistic regression is being built by Excel Miner. Done. So click on this run. This is your output. You have detailed reports for validation score, detailed report for training scores. Yeah, you have lift charts and all that. We'll talk about lift charts and all that. But click view here to see the output of your logistic regression. It's taking time. Yeah, so I got the output. LR output is logistic regression output. And if I scroll down, let me click on this, and if I scroll down, I will get the logistic regression equation. Again, I think it's got stuck. Model predictors, and yeah, this is your regression model. Yep. Come on. Cloud based is taking a lot of time. There, little bit up. Almost there. This is the issue. Let me just check if I have this done already. And let me just pull that for you guys. Yeah. Just launching the file. Yeah, so this is the same output which we have done on Excel Miner. Of course, it was done before the expiry of the Excel Miner software. So this is your model equation. You can see regression model there. So your equation is logit of rain at time is equals to 1 is equals to beta naught, which is 1.027 plus beta 1, which is minus 1.15 into rain at lag 1 plus 0.22, rounded off to 22 with sine t, and plus 0.25 into cos of t. So this is your equation. We will substitute these values in this, and we'll get a value for logit function. And then using this logit value, we calculate probability of rain of t is equals to 1 using the function 1 plus e power minus logit. When we substitute that value here, we will get the probability. And using this cutoff value, by default we are saying it is 0.5. Using this cutoff value, we will say whether the event is a true event or false event. That means if the probability of this rain at time period t is greater than 0.5, then we will assume that it is going to rain. But if it is less than or equal to 0.5, then we assume that it is going to be no rain on that particular day. By default, we are saying the cutoff value is 0.5, mind that. But we can also choose this cutoff value using ROC curve, and there is something called as AUC, under area under the curve. Area under the curve. Well, we'll look into that. Right, so here the output that we are getting is binary. Right? Now, when I have binary data, how would I measure the accuracy of the any model? How can I measure the accuracy, guys? If the data is binary? Confusion matrix, exactly. We have to look into the confusion matrix, wherein we are comparing the results. So we'll get, when you actually substitute these values, we are getting logit as minus 1.339, and this is 0.21, probability is less than 0.5. Hence, we assume that it is not going to rain on this particular day, 3654 day. 3654 is January 1st, 2010. This is what we are predicting. Right? So this way we'll be calculating that, and this is the cutoff value. So these are the probabilities that we have got. We're checking whether it is going to rain or not, and the probability whenever it is less than 0.5, we are saying it is zero. But actually few days it rained also. So we have to cross compare this events. That is done using confusion matrix. will come back to us. So this is the confusion matrix, because we also have to see sensitivity and specificity. We'll talk about that now. So confusion matrix, we are saying whether it is going to rain or not, right? That's what we are predicting based on the actual data. Let's say it rained and it did not rain. These are your actual values. And we are predicting that it is raining and it is not raining. This is predicted value. Now, all the cases where you are predicting that rain is falling and in actually the rain is falling, yeah, then it is called as true positive calculations, true positive, true predictions. But on the days when it did not rain, if your prediction says it rained, then it is a false positive, false prediction. Similarly, on the days when it rained, but if you are predicting that it did not rain, again, this is a false prediction. And on the days when it did not rain and your prediction model also says it did not rain, then it is a true prediction. Right? And if I have to measure accuracy, we will be looking into this true predictions by total. And here we have to talk about few measures like this. So here we have to talk about sensitivity, specificity. These are important because if I have to decide on what is that cutout value which is best suited, then I have to come up with an ROC curve. Where is that ROC curve? I don't have. Oh, very good. Give me a second. Let me just pull it up. I don't have ROC curve here. Okay. Yeah, so I'm just pulling it up. Okay, right. So by looking at this ROC curve, we have to come up with an appropriate cutoff value as well. And this ROC curve, which is also called as receiver operating characteristic, right, was eventually or was actually come up with, or this study was discovered or invented in World War II, wherein the enemy was sending false signals to divert the army. They wanted to identify the difference between true signals from false alarms. Yeah, so that you're not getting diverted by the false alarms that the enemy was sending us, radio signals. And here, if you see, we have to talk about true positive rate, this one, and false positive rate, which is nothing but specificity. So to understand these, we'll have to look into this definitions. So here I have actual case and here I have predicted case. This is confusion matrix. And what we are saying is, if in actual, the disease is present and if you are predicting as present, then it is a true prediction. Yeah, but if you are predicting that the disease is not present, when you actually see that there is a disease, then it is false negative, which is very dangerous. This scenario is very dangerous. What happens eventually, the customer or the patient is going to die. In actual, he has, let's say, cancer. But your model says you don't have cancer. So he's going to lead his normal life without any medications and all that. And ultimately, the cancer within his body is going to increase and is going to be ultimately die. So we have to get this value as zero. We have to eliminate this. And that's given as sensitivity calculation. If you see here, it is also called as recal hit rate or true positive rate. So out of the actual diseases cases, how many times you were correctly predicting? So actual disease cases was given by two positive plus false negative. Yeah, these are your actual diseases, right? So out of these cases, actual positives, how many times you were correctly predicting? This is sensitivity. Now, if you look at specificity, we talk about true negative by true negative and false positive. That means on how many instances you were correctly identifying that a disease is not present. Yeah, so this is the correct prediction. This is did not exist in actual, and your prediction also says they did not exist. So how many times were you correctly predicting that case in out of total negative cases? Hence it is called as true negative rate. Sensitivity is true positive rate. This is true negative rate. Right? And we have to take 1 minus specificity here. False positive rate. And we plot this ROC curve based on these values. And here you have to understand the curve better. So what we basically talk about here is we have this black dotted lines. This is called as this diagonal is called as classifier with no predicted value, and that is considered as a baseline value here. This is called as a baseline. And this is of no use. If your model falls here, it's no use. It is like ambiguity situation. You're not able to predict whether the output is going to be 1 or 0. It says 50% 1, 50% 0. Right? So it is of no use. And the model that we are going to build is compared with this baseline. And whenever we have a vertical line like this, the red dotted line, this is called as a perfect classifier. That means if every time you have a patient with cancer, you are perfectly saying that yes, you have cancer. True positive rate will always be 100%. That means you are not predicting any patient who has cancer as don't have cancer. Right? That's very important. So true positive rate should be 100%, and that is your perfect classifier. And whenever you have horizontal line, that is going to be a pathetic model. You're exactly predicting the opposite way. You don't want such scenarios. And the actual case would never be a perfect classifier, or it will never be a total dumb case. And this blue curve is what we generally get. And the area under this blue curve is basically talking about the test classifier accuracy. And if you see this test classifier, if it is 90% to 100%, 0.9 to 1, that is nothing but this red line, red dotted line, then it is an outstanding model, which is nothing but perfect classifier. As in how the area under that curve comes down, your prediction model is coming down a little bit, and this is nothing but area under the curve that we are calculating. And using this, of course, we have to tweak your cutoff value so that we have best accuracy. So using the training data, we have to decide on what cutoff value is best. So choose the cutoff point which maximizes true positive rate, and ultimately it has to minimize your false negative case, because this has to be zero. False negative should be zero. Yep. So that's where you use this cutoff value. For now, we are assuming it is 0.5 and we are predicting. And this is how you get, this is your validation data prediction where you have the confusion matrix. Actual cases, you are saying 1 and 0 and predicted 1 and 0. And 492, the correct predictions are 1980 correct predictions. So on 492 cases, when rain was falling, your prediction the prediction model was also saying it was raining. It would rain. And when it was not raining in actual, on 1980 cases, the value correctly predicted, the model correctly predicted. Now, if you look into the complete result summary, this is how it looks like. Training data summary, and this is on validation data. Here you have 101, 320 correct predictions. And this is the error report. Of course, you have the percentage calculation, error calculation here. And using this, we will be also calculating sensitivity of a classifier and specificity of a classifier. And using this, of course, as I said, you will be calculating the ROC curve and then deciding the cutoff value. So if you observe here, sensitivity on validation data is nothing but true positives. So this is nothing but 101 true positive divided by total 101 plus 173. That's your true positivity or sensitivity calculation, and which is 36.8%. And specificity, which is nothing but 320 true negative by true negative plus false positive. So 74 plus 320 is the denominator, which is 394, and if you see 81.2%. This is how you calculate sensitivity and specificity, and it is already given in our data set. And when we have 0.3 as the cutoff value, this you can also check. I mean, you can change the cutoff value and try and see and increasing the accuracy of the model. So you can change the cutoff value, or you look into other predictor values which might influence the rainfall, right? And we are going to build a lot of models here by tweaking and then checking the performance on validation data. So same process needs to be applied here, just like what we have done for normal cross-sectional logistic regression data. And if you look into the output here, you can see the calculation. Once again, look at that. Specificity, sensitivity is already calculated here. This for the regression output model. Training data source. This is not working. Yeah, you can see here sensitivity is 37%, specificity is 84% for training data. Responding, the system is not responding. It's taking so much time. All right, any questions, friends? Let me see the questions. Shamim, I was explaining cutoff value all the while, right? But while pre-processing of data, we assign 1 or 0 based on range values. If there is small fraction value, then we consider it as range, but in the output, we have taken a base value, and any value more than that base value, it is range or else not range. Anup, we are talking about the probability. The base value that you are talking about is the chance of rain. We are not saying whether it rained or not. What is the probability that it might rain? And if the chance is greater than 50%, then we say yes, it is raining. That is the cutoff value, right? By default, it is 50%. And by looking at the training data and calculating this sensitivity and specificity, you can come up with that ROC curve and then decide what is the best value. What would be the best cutoff value that you might want to see? While partitioning the data, what would we write to partition in season wise? Example, we have data for 10 years. So training data, yeah, you can do that, Raviraj. Because it was too much of data, very huge data set, I've took it into percentage terms. But absolutely, you can take 8 years and 2 years wise also. So that, yeah, we are also covering seasonality, 2 years. Makes sense. What's the meaning of the sine and cos seasonality? You may have. Okay, so sine and cos are used to capture the seasonality from this daily data. Where you have 365 days, right, on seasonality. So you cannot come up with 365 dummy variables to capture the seasonality. Hence, we use the sine and cos values, which eventually are trying to help us capture the seasonality. Tejaswini, the calculation of sine and cos, I think I've explained you. Sine. The equation is sine of 2 pi t by 365.25. Similarly, same thing for cos also. Pi is a constant, 3.14. T is a time period index. Based on the time period, 1, 2, 3 takes the sequence numbers. You will be calculating the sine value and cos value.
So the sine and cos seasonality is only applicable for daily data?
Yes, when you have too much data, yes, we use this.
Okay.
See, whenever we have seasonality, we try to capture the seasonality using the dummy variable. We create those many dummy variables and we try to capture them. But here you cannot come up with 365 dummy variables, right? Hence we use this formula, and there is a very lengthy explanation of why we have to use this, how it actually captures the seasonality and all that. You can read that offline. Okay, all right, so if you see here, In cloud, I will not be able to show you this curves. The lift charge things is not possible. Hence, I have something like this, which is previously done, which talks about this lift chart. You have to use this lift chart, ROC curve, and here you can see the area under this curve, area under the curve. Sensitivity and specificity. We have to try and take the cutoff value which maximizes this area under the curve. Okay, so change from 0.5 to 0.3 or 0.2 or 0.4 and see what is this curve that you are getting. Is it increasing or not? Yeah, largest the area under the curve on training data is better cutoff value that you want to choose. Yeah, making sense? Shamim?
Yes, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I was asking, is there any formula to calculate the area under curve or any R code or any formula?
Yeah, there is an R code, but Excel Miner is doing it for you, right?
Okay.
So when you are doing the same thing in R, you have to write the code for it.
So here, just for calculating the AUC, what I need to do, like what is the navigation?
There is no navigation. I just executed logistic regression, and logistic regression gives all these output.
Okay, in the summary or in the results, I will get these values. Yes. I will get the values.
Yes, yes. If you see here, when I used logistic regression, there are so many sheets, worksheets it generates. Logistic regression, okay, this is like the summary. On training data, what is the prediction? Logistic regression on training data. On validation data, what it is? Lift chart for training data, lift chart for validation data, and what is the stored values? Stored values is basically talking about the coefficients. So if you have the Excel Miner software installed in your system, like the trial version or licensed version, then you will be able to see this. In cloud version, I'm not able to see this. The graphs are not shown in cloud version, unfortunately. So when I have taken 0.5, this is the curve. This is a random curve. As I said, it is the baseline which is considered. And this area we are calculating, which is 67.49%. We have to try and check. We have not done that, right? We have to do a trial and error. Manually edit that cutoff value from 0.5 to something else. You can do that when you are executing the logistic regression here. And let me show you again. I just click here, logistic regression. It will take some time. So we are basically doing it iteratively, multiple times, and with different cutoff values, we see what is the accuracy on the training data and what is the accuracy on the testing. Let me just select this. Any random value, I mean, anyways, I'm not executing it. So see here, you say cutoff value, specify initial cutoff probability for success. You change this from 0.5 to 0.3 or 0.35, 0.34, whatever the value that you want to check. The Excel Miner is very popular in time series analysis because the calculations, right, are very easy in this. So this just have to give these inputs and automatically the entire calculations are done by this tool. Right, hope this is clear now. So you have to try out multiple times with different cutoff values and check which cutoff value is giving you the best result. Let me cancel this.
Muted.
Yeah, on what basis we go for cutoff values? So on what basis we choose those values?
Random.
Sometimes we choose point size. Sometimes, sorry.
It's
random.
It's so to begin with by default. And when I use point
okay.
size, you can see that area under the curve is 67%. And if I have to get this, you can see this area should be very high.
So normally it is taken as 0.5.
Yes,
most of the times.
Default.
By default. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
It will generally not be same. It has to be similar pages. Otherwise, it is an overfitting value, overfitting case. Yes, Shami. All right, guys, that's it from my side. So we have seen how we are going to use your logistic regression concept on a time series data. So the concepts are similar. We are trying to predict binary values, just that the data now we have is in series, in sequence of time. All right, so that's it. Let's conclude the sessions. Anup, we'll be looking, I'll try to cover that in next webinar. Right now, I don't have any data set readily available. Yes, Tejashwini, see, you can use any tool. Yeah. You have to implement the logics. So in Excel Miner, you are using navigation based in which Excel Miner is in the background is executing some logics or some code. In R, you are writing the code using some functions. You can do it using any programming language, any medium. All right, guys, thank you. Let's meet in the next webinar. Until then, take care and thank you so much and happy learning, guys. Do explore on why we have to use sine and cos. Do explore more about this ROC curve and AUC curve. AUC. Till then, good night, guys. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharath.